In the last class, we were discussing about the characteristic feature of atmosphere and its related weather and climate. In this class today, we like to discuss some of the important weather elements, because these are born from the atmosphere. Let us discuss something on our rainfall. Why I say our rainfall? Without water, there is no life. So, rainfall is very, very important. You know already what is hydrological cycle. Water gets evaporated from the ocean surface, all water bodies. It also gets transpired through plant system, goes as evapotranspiration, and stays in the atmosphere as water vapor. Normally, they live in the atmosphere up to 10 days for a single water vapor molecule. They stay for 10 days, then gets condensed and falls as precipitation. So, one among the precipitation is your rainfall. So, one among the precipitation is your rainfall. Other than that, you have drizzle, you have snow, you have sleet, and you have hail also. These are all some forms of precipitation. In temperate countries, you get snow. In tropical situation, you get rainfall because of the lapse rate that is being operated at the lower part of the atmosphere. Without rainfall, there is no life in the earth. That is already understood. Normally, rainfall is being reported for the past 24 hours. For example, today the rainfall is being recorded by 8:30 a.m. It is said to be 20 millimeter, means in the past 24 hours, there was rainfall up to this quantity. This is very, very important. Next, we move to some theories. I say rainfall, you must understand some basic aspects of rainfall. Rainfall is from both warm clouds as well as your cold clouds. Accordingly, it is being defined by two authors. One is the rainfall from cold clouds. This theory is proposed by Bergeron. He is from Norway. He has proposed Bergeron ice crystal theory for cold clouds. And another one is collision theory proposed by Brown from Australia. This is for warm clouds. Now, let me say simple about your Bergeron ice crystal theory. There is a cloud. The temperature goes below 0 degree centigrade. All water gets freezed into ice crystals except a certain portion. We call it as supercooled water. It stays as a supercooled water, not as ice crystals. If you examine the saturation vapor pressure between these two, ice crystal and this supercooled water, the pressure is more with supercooled water as compared to your ice crystals. What happens? There is a sublimation process, physical process, sudden change from skipping one stage, the vapor goes as a ice crystal and falls over the existing ice crystals, and because of the weight and the gravitational force, it comes as a rainfall. This is for cold clouds. In respect of the warm clouds, the process is coalescence and collision, proposed by Brown of Australia, wherein the temperature does not go below 7 degree centigrade. That is, some warmness is there. Here, small cloud droplets gets collided and becoming a biggest particle of the cloud. Because of the thickness of the clouds and the presence of abundant moisture in the clouds, there is always vertical agitation. The bottom goes to the top, top comes to both. It's like a machinery process. By that, the rain cloud droplets becomes very bigger and falls as a rainfall at a later stage with your gravitational force as well as your weight. These are all some theories proposed, you must understand. Now, coming to the process, theory is something different from the process. What are those processes? For every season, the rain occurs through different processes. For example, during summer, there is convective process because of the solar radiation. The land gets heated. The air above the land also gets heated. It loses density and it gets ascent, goes to the atmosphere, and through adiabatic cooling process, you get rainfall. Another process is orographic rain process. This occurs during monsoon season, especially during southwest monsoon season of India, wherein the trade winds, they travels over ocean, take enough moisture, and this warm and moist water, air, they hits on mountain. As a result, the air goes up, and through adiabatic cooling, you get rainfall. There is warm frontal rainfall also. This occurs during cold weather period, wherein already there is cold air mass exist. Warm air mass comes from somewhere and sits over the your cold air mass and grows like that over addition by addition, and you get rainfall. In the case of the cold frontal rainfall, what happens is already the warm air sits over the cold air mass. Because of natural phenomenon, the cold air mass shifts away, leaving the warm air mass in agitation mode. In addition, the cold air mass pushes the warm air upper side, and through adiabatic cooling, you get rainfall. And another one is rain with cycloning. This is very, very common during northeast monsoon season of India. There is a dense, extensive air mass in the atmosphere, which has converging effect, energy converging. This moves up towards the atmosphere, and through adiabatic cooling, again you get rainfall. Cyclone process is something different. You get a suddenly depression in the your atmospheric pressure. Suppose there is 980 millibar of a portion here. Suddenly, there is a drop in the atmospheric pressure, 978, 975, then you get this process of rainfall. This is very, very important. So, these are all process, and it varies with season. Somebody says that, is there any rule that same rainfall process occurs throughout the year? I think it is not so. It gets varied with season. Then coming to the annual rainfall of important countries, this is very, very important to understand the spatial and the temporal dimension of the rainfall. This is very important. I can say, because of the geographical position of a particular area, that I say latitude and longitude, the climate or the weather also gets changed. Now you see, in the case of Turkey, Asia, the minimum rainfall 360 millimeter. And the maximum could be seen in the South America bottommost layer, it is around 3000 millimeter. Where is 360, where is 3000 millimeter. Similarly, if you take our India as a case, in Jaisalmer, the annual rainfall is 100 millimeter only, annual 100 millimeter. So, how to express? So, rainfall gets varied, the process also gets varied, the theories also get varied. The spatial and the temporal dimension also gets varied. Now, some facts I want to say about rainfall. What would be the size of the rainfall? The droplet size must be more than 0.5 millimeter. People must understand how to call a day as a rainy day or a dry day. If the rainfall is more than 2.5 millimeter, then we call this a rainfall day. Otherwise, the rainfall is lesser than 2.5 millimeter means it gets evaporated as a evaporation, because daily a minimum of 3 millimeter is goes as evaporation. So, lesser than rainfall 2.5 millimeter does not make a day as a rainfall day. Then coming to the intensity of the rainfall, this is also very, very important. Here you can see light rain. There are two subtypes, light rain, very light rain, and one moderate, and three heavy, rather heavy, heavy, and very heavy. This is again based on what is the scale. Is it per hour or per day? I can say that you can call it as per day or per day. When rain starts and completes by 1 hour in a particular day, then it can say it is a 1 hour scale. Or in a day, it goes on drizzling, 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 then it calls a per day. So if the rainfall is more than 12.5 centimeter, that is 125 millimeter, then we call it as a very heavy rainfall. Heavy means the classification is here, 6.5 to 12.5 centimeter, rather heavy. Then moderate, this is always moderation is very, very important, moderate rainfall. Here I like to say one thing. In the case of European countries, the rainfall is 2 mm per day. If you come to countries like India, the rainfall is 20 mm per day. See, this is due to some variations. In the temperate countries, the rainfall process is mainly due to cold frontal rain or warm frontal rain. But in respect of our Indian condition, you have cyclonic storm, you have orographic rain. That's why the rainfall quantity gets varied. Then why rainfall is very important to crops, not only to crops, but also to all human, cattle, and everything, every life. We call in agriculture, crop production, effective rainfall. This is nothing but the amount of moisture or the amount of rainfall that gets infiltrated into the soil profile and stored as soil moisture. This soil moisture is going to be used by the crop as evapotranspiration for its growth and multiplication and also giving yield. So effective rainfall is very, very important. We say that 60% of the rainfall received to be the effective rainfall in the case of not considering the antecedent soil moisture. Suppose today's rainfall is 100 millimeter, the effective rainfall is 60 millimeter. In the case of the dry land agriculture, the entire crop production depends upon your rainfall. If you take, for example, India, 44% of total annual production comes from the dry land agriculture, thus indicating the importance of rainfall for dry land agriculture, whether it may be in India or Australia or any other country. The other important aspect of rainfall is irrigated agriculture. Whenever rain falls on your land, the water goes inside the soil profile as infiltration and it reaches the deeper layer and getting stored as groundwater. That groundwater is being used for your irrigated agriculture. So irrigated agriculture is very, very important because here the reduction, risk reduction is very, very important as compared to your dry land agriculture. Then crop water requirement, this is very, very important. You have your food requirement per day, calories 2,200 to 2,500 calories per day your requirement. Like that, plant also, crop also requires water for its growth. That is being discussed in the next slide. Now you can see, have taken the rice crop, its evapotranspiration, the water loss from the soil goes as 1,200 to 1,400 millimeter, either as evaporation or like your transpiration through the plant process. So we have given different example for this crop. Temperate crop is given, tropical crops are given. You kindly see all those things. So here one interesting point is, whenever the evapotranspiration is more, the yield also would be more. For example, you see rice, the evapotranspiration goes up to 1,400 millimeter and the yield is 5 tonnes per hectare. If you come to pulses on the right side, its ET is 250 to 300 millimeter, the yield also 200 to 300 kg per hectare. So in the absence of the ET, the yield also will be getting reduced, indicating that rainfall is mostly required for crop production if you want to sustain or increase your grain yield from the crops. Now let me say what are the instruments let us use to measure the your rainfall. Internationally, the rain is to be measured by 3 GMT. For India, plus 5.30 hours, it becomes 8:30 a.m. in the morning. So for having an international comparison, we have to record rainfall by 3 GMT in all the countries. There is one ordinary rain gauge. It is has to be managed by the manually. And one is a self-recording rain gauge. It is being operated by through a battery or your like a clock. Then a dipping bucket. This is automatic sensor equipments being fitted with your automatic weather station. So these are the some things that I like to discuss on the rainfall for today's class. Thank you very much.